1971 Indo-Pak war was at its peak. Race to Dhaka had begun. It was time to take surgical and decisive actions. Indian Army decided to conduct its first ever helibone attack. Then young Major Ian Cardozo and his brave Gurkha troops were airdropped deep inside enemy territory. Their objective was to secure Silhet Air Base and to give a mighty, mighty bloody nose to enemy's defenses. What a war it was. For 9 hellish days and nights, these brave Gurkha troops kept up the offensive, and the enemy shivered at the mere war cry of Ayo Gorkhali, Jai Mahakali. Accidentally stepping on a landmine, Major Ian Cardozo suffered grievous injury on his leg. In middle of battle zone, without any morphine, without any surgical equipments, this brave officer took out his kukri and hacked the injured leg off and continued on in the battle zone. Unbelievable, unbelievable story. True to the Catfit motto that mind matters, Major General Ian Cardozo, Ati Vishisht Seva Medal, Sena Medal Gallantry, has shown us that if mental courage had a face, if resilience had a face, it would be a face of Major General Cardozo. We are so lucky to have him on our platform today and looking forward to a very, very meaningful and inspiring conversation. Welcome, sir. Jai Hind.
Thank you.
Jai Hind. Good evening, sir. Wonderful to have you on our platform today. Just like the generals would love it, right to the brass tacks, first question. So 1962 was one of the biggest crises that people used to remember in India. Now we have the pandemic. You are somebody who has gone through emotional, physical, as well as psychological issues during and post your service. Now, you come out of it every single time because of your ability to cope with adversity and sheer resilience levels. So my question, sir, to you is, what is your message to the youth of today coming out of one of the greatest crises in modern history and for India post-1962?
Thank you, Arpan. A little bit of background. 1962 was followed by 1965, when Pakistan attacked us when we had not fully recovered from 62. But in the army, we have something known as lessons learned. From 62 and 65, we learned our lessons, shaped our policy, shaped our aims and objectives, and won a brilliant victory in 1971. Now, you take the Spanish flu, which took place in after World War II in 1945. What lessons did we learn? I'm afraid we did not learn any lessons. So, what is important is mind over matter, and that is best translated by application of mind. My message to all from these two examples is, firstly, we need to assess the situation. Having assessed the situation and analyzed the problem, then we have to apply the mind and face the situation. In the army, we call it biting the bullet. We don't run away from a situation. We face it, we bite the bullet and sort out the problem. So find the solution. And that solution may have problems, but we should never be afraid. We should do what is right, irrespective of the consequences. Never be afraid and never give up. You will see from the above that this mental resilience, this power of the mind, is application of the mind over matter. That's my message.
Wonderful, sir. Sir, the war is a grim reality. But we have seen that it is always, always glamorized in movies. So you were in Sylhet in the first heli-borne operation undertaken by Indian Army. With half a battalion strength of Gurkhas, say 582 Jawans to be precise, you went into the war and made 8,000 Pakistanis surrender, sir. We would really like to ask you, sir, that where did this mental strength and courage come from? Sir, do share this story for us, because it really would carry lots of messages for the youth out there.
Yeah, I'd like to firstly, there has been a message in what I had said earlier on various media platforms. We were not 584, we were 384. So we started the war with just 384 because the leave parties hadn't fetched back from Nepal, and we had suffered heavy casualties in the Battle of Atkaram and Ghazipur.
Sir. So
what was the situation when we received the message that we have to capture Atkaram, capture Sylhet? At that point of time, we had lost, we had entered the war with 18 officers. By that time, 3 had been killed, sir, and 4 had been wounded. So there were only 11 officers left out of 18. And similarly and proportionally, we had lost a lot of men. So the CO was getting together to reorganize the battalion when he was told that this is what you have to do. He said, I need time. They said, there is no time. The brigade which was in Sylhet has vacated Sylhet and gone for the defense of Dhaka. I want you to go immediately. It's a long story. Sir. I'll cut it short. So the CO said that he doesn't really believe that Sylhet could be vacated, because Sylhet was an important defense position of General Niazi's fortress policy of defending Dhaka. Sylhet was providing defense depth to Dhaka. But he said, no, accept the situation. There is nobody there. So he applied his mind and said, okay, this is what they're saying. I really don't believe it. What should I do? And therefore, he took the confidence of his officers and his men and the JCOs, and they decided that instead of taking food, water, blankets, and other accessories, they will take only more ammunition and grenades. So that is application of the mind. Then,
sir, if I could draw your attention to, you know, there are, not everyone can join the Indian Army, and but everyone requires mental toughness. So we at CATFIT, for example, we go to school, colleges and corporate organizations, wherein veteran of the Special Forces and the NSG, they provide mental toughness training to people. So what is your message to people? How important really is mental toughness over physical fitness, or mental toughness in general?
See, in my opinion, mental toughness is a part of mind over matter. It's a part of application of the mind. It is important. It is a part of combination of physical courage and moral courage. Therefore, it is important. What I would like to say is, how can we develop this? That's your question. How can we develop this attitude, this mental toughness? I believe it starts from the home. It starts from the family, the values that the mother and the father give the child right from childhood. That is followed up by schools and colleges. My values were shaped by my mother and father. My mother told me, never do anything wrong for which I will have to hang my head in shame. And my father said, do not be afraid. You are going to lead men and lead them into battle. Never be afraid. So it started from my home. And then I learned good values from my school, St. Xavier's School and St. Xavier's College. That was further enhanced in my battalion. So there are three stages: family, education institutions, and the corporate or the military institution you belong to. Therefore, I would suggest that CatFit has a bigger aim and a bigger plan. If you want to change, change not only small portions of this country, plan to change India. And for that, when you have your programs, have a day by which the parents of those people are also called. Or tell these young adults that one day they are going to be parents, and therefore family attitudes are very important. And then I'm very happy to know that you carry them into the corporate sector. So in this manner, family, institutions, education institutions, corporate sector, you can change the face of India. But basically, it is attitude. Attitude shapes behavior. Behavior shapes conduct, and conduct shapes outcome. So attitude, behavior, conduct, outcome. So again, it is mind over matter. Mind is the most important thing. Unfortunately, we do not tax the mind enough. We are mentally lazy. Therefore, what you are doing is a great job, enhancing the capacity of the mind to assess situations, analyze the problem, find solutions, not be afraid, and then ensure that the outcome is right.
How rightly put, sir. How rightly put. And we assure you that this roadmap that you have laid out in front of us, we will try to prove worthy of it and take all these nuggets of wisdom, sir, because they are pure gold.
Thank you.
Sir, the Battle of Atrav, as we have just spoken, is a story that legends are made of. It is the only Khukri attack in military history. Sir, I request you to please share that story with us, and keeping in view that how leadership and warrior mindset can absolutely change the face of the war, can change the face of any adversity. We really would like to hear about it, sir.
Yeah. Yashika, it boils down to the same thing which Arpan is saying, and what you are saying, and what you are doing, and that is application of the mind. Mental toughness is an application of the mind. My commanding officer, Lieutenant Colonel Arun Bhimrao Harolikar, was the commanding officer of the 4th Battalion, the 5th Gurkhas. And when he got this order that he was to capture Atgram, he was told that you will not get artillery fire. So we were without any covering fire. We had to capture an objective 1-to-1, because normally it is 3-to-1. It was an objective which was surrounded by water. There was only one dry approach, which was heavily mined. And the CO now applied his mind. If he had to capture this objective without arty fire, without mortars, without MMGs, how was he to do it? So he decided that the only way is surprise. And so he decided to launch what is known as the last Khukri attack in modern military history. He decided to use the principle of war of surprise, to attack the enemy in the middle of the night on an approach not expected by him, and a silent Khukri attack. The enemy did not know what hit them when, in the middle of the night, we got on top of them with the war cry of Ayo Gurkhali, Jai Mahakali. And before they knew what happened, the Khukris were flashing that moonlight night and heads literally rolled. Many of them were killed. Those who survived, actually, we decimated C Company of 31 Punjab and attached troops. Those who survived ran back and told their fellow comrades, don't mess with the Gurkhas, you're liable to lose your head. That stood us in good stead, both in the next battle at Ghazipur, as well as in the Battle of Sylhet. Yeah, I would like to ask Arpan as sure. to you're doing a great job by
thank you, sir,
by introducing mental toughness as a value, as a lesson learned, as something in an attitude to develop. Can you tell us something about your programs?
So there are several programs that we are conducting at the grassroots level, grassroots levels. And primary ones are wherein we are conducting psychological evaluations to determine the psychological, mental, and emotional health of children and people in corporates. Once we've identified their mental health or psychological health, then we provide them with counseling. And post that, speakers and motivational speakers like Captain Yashika, they come in and provide mental toughness training. So this is one program. Second program is wherein we've got people from the Special Forces and the Black Cats who go to institutions and organizations and teach military grade self-defense. So that is what we are that is what we are doing. Third program is we know that there are almost 200,000 people who die in road accidents every year. There are almost 20 lakh people who suffer from heart attacks. But the fact of the matter is that there is nobody who knows basic CPR, who knows basic trauma management or basic first aid. So trauma management, CPR and first aid, this is one of our primary programs as well, where our concept is if we teach the students of today trauma management, CPR and first aid, we can cut down in terms of casualties on the road or because of heart attacks that take place. Lastly, we've got for the corporates, we've got an elite leadership program wherein we are passing the best of breed, best of services from the lessons that have been learned from the Indian Defense Services into the corporates and how they can become better leaders like the Special Forces or Black Cat officers.
Oh, that's wonderful. And can I ask Yashika a question?
Please, sir.
Please do, sir.
So Yashika, you're a veteran of the Kargil War.
Sir.
What are the lessons that you have learned from the Kargil War which you are passing on to the people who you train on mental toughness?
Sir, I'm a Kargil War veteran. And also from the very, very initial batches of lady officers being inducted into Indian Army. So coming into Army by itself was absolutely a very, very different and a very difficult career choice. I think my mindset stood me in good stead when I joined Army, when I got through my training into Academy, passed out with medal, and also after that got posted to uncongenial climate areas. The warrior mindset, the attitude of never say die, never back off, resilience, these are the things, sir, which you also have narrated, which you also have passed on to us through your stories. Sir, when I joined CATFIT, my basic aim was to share my service experience plus mindset plus the experiences to the corporates, to the students, and to the youth in general. Sir, I'll share with you that we did a corporate training program with a multinational company that is, I think, number one European company in electrical and electronics. And when we did that program, the thing that we passed on to them was how corporate is a war zone in its own sense, and how a warrior mindset is going to not only make you survive, but also going to make you stay ahead of the learning curve, to keep you fighting the competition and to survive it. And sir, believe you me, we did a complete 360 degree program as to how to be mentally tough, how to be physically tough, how to be nimble, agile, and alert, and not given to any stress situation that is coming, how to counter the stress, how to develop that warrior mindset. And the response that we got was amazing. They said that we feel like we are boots on ground. We feel like we are actually that burning soul of the boot, and we are ready to fight on into our day-to-day battles where career, family, stress environment, health, everything is at stake, and where we take on everything and move on. It was a very, very wonderfully received program by this multinational, sir. So we are moving on ahead. I am trying to pass on whatever I can to all the different cross sections of society.
So, General Cardozo, my next question is to you, and it's quite long, so probably I'll read it out. So your heroic act during battle zone meant a difficult life after that. So it was a heroic act, yes, but then physically and mentally, it was going to be a difficult life. So CATFIT believes in mental toughness and attitude of never giving up. We understand it is the key to success. How did you come to terms with the loss of a limb in the prime of your life and career? So this is the first part of the question. First, you could answer this. Then I'll come to the next part of this question.
Strangely, I think the answer to this is one word. And that one word is love. Now you might say, what does this army general know about love? But the issue is, that I loved my life in the army, and I was not prepared to change my way of life. And I thought to myself, I need to find a way out by which I can continue to command troops. At that time, the mindset of the army was quite clear. You become a battle casualty, you lose a limb, forget about coming back to troops. We will keep you in the army, but you will be a babu. You will do a staff job for the rest of your life. I was not prepared to accept that. But I did not know how I would achieve my aim. So the answer, I think, looking back, is out-of-box thinking. Applying and hoping and or going to court, etc., was not the answer. The answer was to prove to the army that I was as good as anybody else. And therefore, I decided to get myself physically tough, mentally tough, accept the challenge and find a solution. And the solution, when you have the right attitude, when you have the right mindset, when you're determined, when love is backing you up, there is a God above. And I do believe that God has helped me in many ways. An opportunity came my way when I had to do a battle physical efficiency test. And I proved, I kept on training every day. I used to run about 5 to 6 kilometers every day. I ran so much that the metal bolt securing the foot with the wooden leg broke. But I was doing 5 to 6 kilometers a day. And when the test came, I came ahead of 7 other people with 2 legs. And that impressed the officials of the army. And when I applied for the battalion, there were many other tests. It took me 7 years fighting the system to prove that I was as good as anybody else. And then the biggest test came when a boy was drowning in the sea and nobody had the guts to jump in. I had to take off my leg, go into the water and get him back. Wow. After that, I had no problem. People accepted that not only was I as good as them, but in some ways I was better.
Probably, definitely better.
That's the problem actually with most disabled people. We are always got this chip on our shoulder to prove to the world that we are as good, if not better than other people. And so, out-of-box thinking, accepting a challenge, not as a difficulty, not as a problem, but as an opportunity to prove what you want to achieve. So the challenges which came my way proved to be excellent opportunities to prove to the army that I was good as anybody else. And then to never be afraid. That is, as I said earlier, bite the bullet. Don't run away from situations. Fight the situation. Find solutions to problems. And that is what helped. And then, of course, never give up. So
I think you've answered the second part of my question as well, where you were drawing your levels of resilience from. Yes, Captain. Yes,
I would like to say, sir, that personal valor is very important. but mindset is the champion. And sir, you have proven that. I read it somewhere, sir, that Field Marshal Sam Monickshaw and yourself were from the same regiment, and that he gave you some excellent nuggets of wisdom after 1971 war, when you had gone to receive your gallantry award. Sir, this is a very opportune moment when we can request you to share the same nuggets of wisdom with all our viewers. Probably it will be the same lesson that Sam Monickshaw shared with you and you are sharing with us. Please, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Yashika. The thing is that I'm glad you asked this question at the end, because it actually sums up what I have said all along. When I went to, Sam and I belonged to the same regiment, he saw my red lanyard and he came to me and he said, "Son, well done." So I said, "Sir, any advice?" He thought for a moment and then he said, "Love what you do." That is what told me that I love the army, and that is where I want to be for the rest of my life till I retire. So love what you do applies to everyone. If you can choose your profession in a way of life which you love, then you are in a better position to be happy. And every human being wants to be happy. So the first thing he said is, do what you love. Do what you love. And then he said, love what you do. And love what you do means that you have to be the best. Whatever profession you join, whether you're a doctor or a lawyer or an engineer or a professor, be the best. Know as much as possible of your subject. Nobody should know more than you about your profession. So do what you love. Love what you do. And then he said, never be afraid. And he also said that if anybody says he's not afraid, he's either a liar or a Gurkha. Never be afraid. He said also that some people are afraid of one thing, some people are afraid of many things, but never run away from your fears. Never run away from your challenges. Face the challenge, and every little victory that you win by small challenges will give you confidence and empower you. And lastly, he said, never give up, which I think doesn't require any explanation, at the Battle of Dograi. He was given a task to capture Dograi, which was an impossible objective. He captured it, but was ordered to come back, which he considered to be a slur on the honor of his battalion, Three Jat. And when it had to be captured again, he said, I will lead you, many more will die, many more will be wounded. But if I die, I want to be there with you at Dograi. And then he said, there we will be tomorrow morning. And they said, the whole battalion roared in Dograi. And they captured Dograi again and reached the outskirts of Lahore. But what he said is more important. And he said is, battles are won or lost in the mind before they are won or lost on the ground.
Thank you for taking out time today for this conversation with Team CatFit. Ladies and gentlemen, that was Major General Ian Cardozo, war veteran. And the nuggets of wisdom today from this platform are, firstly, do what you love. And when you do what you love, you're not going to regret it. Never be afraid of anything and be willing to bite the bullet. And when you're willing to bite the bullet, face whatever calamities or issues or crises that are facing you, and you're willing to fight them, you are going to come out a winner. Good evening and Jai Hind.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.